Good evening, everyone, and welcome to one more webinar here from Century Financial. My name is Yogesh, and we have done a series of webinars last week on the occasion of World Investors Day, and the entire week was dedicated to the education of the investors. And I see a lot of people who joined my webinar last time, they're back. Very good to see all of you. I hope that good and meaningful information was added during all those sessions. Now, once again, we are back with a different topic today. We did, however, highlighted a very significant event of earnings in my last session, but we never went into too much of details. So the idea was to have a separate session on the earnings, and while I can explain you in a much better way that how earnings are being interpreted, which are the important areas where you should actually focus when you're looking at the earnings report. Before I start, please, if you can, if you have a notepad or a diary, I would suggest you just have a piece of paper or something to note things about, because we are doing these sessions free of cost, but then we try to provide more and more information, and this is something which can be useful to you. If everyone can hear me right now, please give me a okay or a yes so I can proceed, because there is always some network issue which keeps happening. So I just want to make sure that everybody is able to hear my voice, see my presentation, and then we can start. Please, anyone, if you can hear me, just send me a yes or okay. Great, okay. So those who are new, because I see a lot of familiar names, those who are new, how we normally do this, we try to make this more interactive. Now, obviously, I cannot bring everyone here over here to talk and discuss, because it's going to be again a very, very long session otherwise. But what I can do is make this chat option more interactive, because all of you have taken out this time in the evening, and I want to make it worth your time. So please use this chat option and try to answer the questions, try to ask more and more questions. So normally how we do it, we try to cover these small topics, what we are discussing about. And then in between, if you have any questions, please go ahead and ask, and I'll try to answer the questions then and there while we are discussing this, right? So once again, welcome all of you. And as we all know, something we discussed last time, that investments are always subject to risk. Now, whatever I will be telling you here, there will be a lot of segments. So I'm sure by now everybody has a piece of paper and notebook, because I'm carrying my notebook, and I have this habit of keep writing while I'm talking to people and while I'm discussing to people. So maximum retention is there, and also we understand the very basics, and noting down always helps. So when we will be talking about today, first and foremost, the earnings season. Okay, and we will also give you a live demonstration of the platform where you can buy and sell very easily. So just to see the charts, see the market information, what was the impact of a positive earning or a negative earning. So, and there will be a couple of strategies related to how you can trade during the earning season. So all the strategies which you will be understanding over here, please understand the risk obviously applies to all of them. There are no strategies which are 100% guaranteed, or any kind of profit assurance is not here. So whether I'm doing a demo trade or I'm explaining you a strategy, when you do this in your live accounts or any account, please understand the risk always implies. Always talk to a expert consultant first. Always talk to your market consultants, and then try to apply it. Please know the risk before you enter into any kind of strategy. right? Because this is really important. People think that these kind of webinars, whatever I say is going to be 100% true. That's not. We are living in one of the most volatile times. So please do your thorough research, talk to the consultants, understand the risk well, and then only get into this, right? Now, to begin with, we talk about earnings. There is a whole earnings report which comes, but in exact what earnings actually are, because when we talk about earnings, it is involved with money for sure. So we know that there is something to do with money, but why earnings is important and how do we understand the earnings report? Now, even if you're an experienced investor, just try to step back a little and let's try to understand the very basics of how to read a company reports first. Because what happens is earnings are these results. So if you remember back in school, whatever you used to do for entire 1 year, there used to be a report card, right? There will always be a result of what you have done. Earning report for the companies which are listed in stock market, it is a must, because when a company gets listed in stock market, they are taking people's money. Because when the shares come out of any company, what shares actually are? Shares are the companies which are trying to make you business partners. So today, if you're buying $10,000 worth of Apple shares, you're actually investing $10,000 into Apple company, which means if Apple does good, the value of their share goes up and you make money over that. So you're a business partner in Apple. You're a part owner in Apple, right? So if you are the business partner and you're invested in Apple, don't you think that you have the right to know that what is going on with Apple? If so, recently they came with, if you have seen Apple event, what was one thing they came up with recently? Please use your chat options. Let's make this more interactive. What was the most latest Apple product they came up with? Even if you have not read the newspapers, must have seen around, talk to your friends. Please go ahead, answer on your chat option. What was the one new product which Apple came up with last week? I'm going to write the answer for myself here in the notebook. Okay, I'm getting answers now. Go ahead, guys, go ahead. Okay. Someone is saying, okay, okay. Yes, so the correct answer is obviously iPhone 12. More precise answer, iPhone 12 with 5G. 5G was one of the most important things. So we'll take a look also what happened during the time when Apple came up with the news that they are going to come up with the iPhone 12 and, you know, when the phone actually got launched. 5G is one of the most important areas right now, because 5G is this super fast technology which is going to speed up the process of browsing, and data will be used much efficiently. So yes, now when that happened, you all got to know that iPhone 12, why they are doing this event publicly, for the similar reason that the shareholders get to know what is going on with Apple. Similarly, when we talk about the earnings report, it's like a report card, okay? And the report card, which tells you that in the span of, so if it's a quarterly earning report, which mostly it is in case of US companies, in 3 months, how Apple as a company has performed, how much money they made, how much money they made for the shareholders, how much revenue they generated, is there any new news they have come up with? What is the expectation of the next quarter? How much money they are going to make in the next quarter? All these kind of things comes in the earnings report. Now, your question will be, and please, if you have any questions, keep writing over the chat. Your questions will be, why do I have to care about earnings? If these guys are coming up with their earnings, if Apple or Amazon or Facebook, if they're coming up with their earnings report, why do I care about it? Because it affects the price of the stock which you have purchased. If you are an Apple shareholder, Apple earning is very important for you. if you are a Facebook shareholder, if you are an ExxonMobil shareholder, Microsoft, or any company which is listed in stock market will come up with the earnings on quarter-on-quarter basis. So you have to be very careful during these times because there is a lot of movement which happens. Now, how much movement happens is for later. First, how to actually read this earnings report? Now, please remember this. There are consultants, there are experts who can do this for you. But since we are doing this in a kind of workshop mode, so I'm going to take you through this entire experience that how you actually decipher the earnings report. Because first thing you see, okay, I want to invest into Apple, right? Or I want to invest into Uber, or I want to invest into, let's say, any other stock, Johnson & Johnson or Walmart or Boeing. But then you have to understand that if you have not properly analyzed the stock by looking at its earnings, then it's not the point to read any other fundamental news about it. Because if there are if the numbers are not right, then news will have a very little impact. And most probably there will be no positive news. So, okay, somebody is saying during the pandemic year, the earnings quarter on quarter will give correct picture. So very important question. So let's keep this question in, and then we'll talk about what happens in this year of pandemic. Do earnings really matter or not? So absolutely good question, and we'll take this through. Now, first, how to read the earnings report? Earnings report, it will be very easily available to you guys. So because these are publicly disclosed reports, you can always go to their websites and find this. Now, first and foremost, every earnings report of a publicly traded company, they produce it every quarter, and it's called a 10Q report. If it is annual, then it is called a 10K report. Now, what normally this particular report signifies, it will tell you whatever you need to know, like the important parts, where you will see, like, for example, financial position of the company is one. Any other relevant information the company want or they should share. And see, there are a lot of, if you see, while all these publicly traded companies, they're required to produce these earning documents by SEC. SEC is the regulatory body. How in other parts of the world, there are different regulatory bodies which are regulating the stock market. In India, it is SEBI. In UK, it is FCA. So similarly here, in US, it is SEC, which is called Securities and Exchange Commission. Many of them, they actually want to disclose earnings because this is an opportunity for them to share the current state of the business, right? Imagine if Apple comes up with a very good earnings result as compared to previous quarter. So there will be more shareholders which will be willing to buy. And what as an investor you get? As an investor, you can use these reports and you can try whether the company is worth investing it or not. You look at their management, you look at their financials, you look at the legal issues, market trends. So this is like an excellent way for you as an investor to gain insight, right? So this is what we'll be doing. Now, I talked about 10Q report. I talked about 10K report, which is a quarter-on-quarter report from any company. Now, I'll take a couple of examples over here. I'll show you what is the how a 10Q report actually looks like. So if you see here, see, this is just an introduction. It's a sample report of General Electric. Okay. If you see, there are different sections, forward-looking statement, management discipline and analysis. So it's a more 106 pages report. And on the pages 112 and 119, there is legal proceedings, financial statements. So consider this as a complete summary of the entire activity which happens, issues related to. So how it works out, this is what you're looking for General Electric. And this is just a template, a sample of how a 10K or a 10Q report looks like. They cover different pages on financial resources, liquidity, management discipline, financial statements. Also, what are the segments which General Electric is invested in? So if you see in the bottom of this particular slide, General Electric is into power. So note it down if you want. So this will help you to understand that why we need segmentation for our, why we need to learn that why segmentation is important during the earnings. So if you see the power, General Electric is definitely into power. They are into renewable energy also. They are into oil and gas also. They are into aviation industry. If you see outside, if you're sitting on the window seat and you can see the engine just next to the wing, you will see it says GE. Sometimes it says Rolls Royce. So depends on which company has made it. But GE is into aviation also. Then they are into healthcare as well. They are into transportation, lighting, capital. So all these kind of segments they are into. So when the earnings come out, most probably every segment, how they performed also comes out. So we'll later understand that what is the importance of the whole segmented area, right? Now, next, how do you best read a company's report? You will spend a lot of time on the financials. You will see, the earnings, but which is the right way to actually understand? Because there are a lot of financial statements which are in, right? Now, as you're not an accountant, so your first question will be, what do I do with all these expenses report and everything? But the understanding what you need to have is, when you have the earnings report with you, there are few important points which you should definitely look into or you should not avoid. Okay, how you read it, it might look complicated. And I actually, understand the part and accept the fact that it can be super boring. But then if you read through it, and as I said, there are people who can take care of it, but then since it's a workshop, I will explain you how you do it. You will see different factors into it. So for example, let's start with the very, very first sector, what you see. Now there are different sections which you will have to see in their earnings report: income statement, total revenue, cost of sales, gross margin, operating expenses, net income, and then earning per share. So first we will see when you're reading an earnings report, what you need to watch. And then when the news comes out, what you need to watch and then how to trade into it. So first thing, what is income statement? Now, income statement is the very first thing which you will see. And I will show you how an income statement looks like. So this is just a demonstration of Apple. We took an example of GE to show you how a sample report looks like. Now, I'm taking this March 2020 and March 2019. So the how often the earnings come out? I told you every quarter, right? We are talking about quarterly earnings. January, February, March. March is quarter. April, May, June, right? So when the earnings are coming out in April, they are looking at Jan, Feb, March. When the earnings are coming up in July, they are looking at April, May, and June. When earnings are coming in October, which is the month currently, they're looking at July, August, September. Now, after October, the earnings, again, October, November, December. So the next earning comes out in January, which will be Q4. So this is how every 3 months the earnings come out. Now, what you are currently looking at, a lot of numbers, but I just want you to focus on a few important things. March 2020 and March 2019. So there is a quarterly review and the difference which I'm showing you for the Apple. So you will see there is a small difference in the budget. The first factor you see is net income. This is how income statement looks like. And if you see in the previous slide which I showed you, revenues, expenses, and profit. So when you're looking at the income statement, it will basically, it tells you that how much money, and please note this down if you are still listening to me, how much money that company has made in a certain period of time. Now, this can be the current quarter income. It can be compared to previous quarters also, but basically very in layman language at how much money the company has made. So this is one thing which is an income statement. Now, income statement, you will see all the adjustments. Let me take you through the one important slide over here. So if you see in the bottom of this slide, they have total comprehensive income. Right. So in the net income, you add change in foreign currency translation, net of tax, something which you can also add into how much debt or securities and everything is there. So when we are talking about net income, there are a lot of other factors which you can see. And net income, there are different formulas to calculate it, but then you are not a financial analyst. So all basically you will see is whatever is the total sales, you subtract the actual cost of the goods sold, and this will have general expenses, administrative expenses, operating expenses, interest, and whatever is remaining is your net income. So net income is not that difficult to calculate it. You calculate if whatever is their total revenue, you reduce down the cost which has incurred, you reduce down any other expenses, and that's where the net income comes in. And by the end of the slide, we will learn more about how net income is calculated, right? So basically, when you're looking at income statement is going to tell you the total revenue, the expenses, and the profit. So it is also, it includes the profit and loss for a company. And it is very easy when you are looking at the income statement that whether the company ended with a net profit or a net loss. Now that particular result, you can compare it with the previous quarter. So for example, this is October 2020, right? Now October 2020 results should be compared with October 2019, and it should also be compared with the previous quarter, which was July 2020. So if you are taking out with, let's say, for example, excuse me for a while. Yeah. If you're looking at, let's say, October 2020 results, then you compare it with October 2019, and then you also compare it with July 2020. So a quarter before and the year ago in the same quarter. So it helps you understand that over a period of year and over a period of quarter, whether the company has made progress or not. And these are very easily available. These numbers are very easily available. If you talk to any of your consultants or experts, they can easily decode it for you, right? So this is something how an income statement would look like. And this is just a very small part of it. Obviously, the bigger statement, when you will see, it will have more and more things. As I said, cost of goods sold and everything. There are a lot of expenses, which are general expenses, which goes into the P&L account. So income statement is also followed by a profit and loss account, and which comes within the, so I'll share one PDF with you, which will show you the entire statement. It's a big document and you can easily see it. Now, second thing which you need to see is total revenue. And in revenue, we'll talk about segmented revenue also. There's an example of Apple, and these are previous numbers taken from Statista, but let me give you a little brief about what total revenue is and how important it actually is when you are determining an earnings report. Now, again, income statement, how much money the company has made. Total revenue, it is also called total sales. Layman language, note this down. Total revenue is how much the company actually did in sales during a specific period of time. Now, when you see as the success of the company is not indicated just by total revenue, because total revenue will not have the cost subtracted, right? So for example, if you're talking about rent or logistics or people, so these are not reduced. But if you see, take a quick snapshot, and you want to understand that how company is trending in terms of their sales. And it's very important, because if you see, now let me show you here about the total sales bit. So we'll discuss the segmented part. Now over here, what you see, same balance, statement. Now you're looking at a statement where it shows the net sales, then products, service, and then total net sales, right? So total revenue, you can look this three ways. First, and now I'm talking about a very specific report, so just hear me out. Sales have been flat over the course of the year, and they are not generating enough new business, right? You can say that if you see March 28 on 2020 and March 30, 2019, during that entire year, if you see total net sales, the first way to see is that the total sales, which we saw, it has been completely flat. Over the course, they are not generating enough new business. They are making the same income, but new business not there. Second way to see this, that the very cost of making those sales have gone up. Now, if you come down a bit, okay, compare, just go down a bit and see the cost of sales, you will see that while the total sales in March 2020 and 2019 were pretty much same, the revenue, the cost of sales, the cost which was generated to make those sales have increased, right? See in both the areas, even if you see 3 month ending or 6 months ending, you will see that in both the cases, while the revenue got affected less or the total sales got affected less, the cost to do these sales were varying a lot. So this is another way to see it, right? Last, for example, there have been, let's say, any unforeseen market risk which caused these sales to flatten, but they're still staying competitive. Best example, guys, best example is the pandemic. So the idea is very simple. If during the pandemic, whatever results come now, compared to previous year, if results are not much deviated, then that is a good news for the company. Because as I said, when you're looking at total sales and you're looking at the cost of sales, if they have managed to keep the cost same or slightly higher, but if there has been any unforeseen situation, so if during pandemic we saw that there have been a lot of shutdowns, a lot of loss of business, but if there are companies who have managed to keep their balance sheet strong, to keep their costs low and sales continuing, then they are the winners during this, and a decent amount of shareholders are going to buy that kind of stock. So this is something which you can see firsthand when you're looking at the report. There are three kinds of analysis which we just did right now while looking at this report. One was that the revenue has been, the total sales have been pretty flat. There have been not much changes as compared to last year till now. But then another way, when we saw that the cost of these sales have increased, another way, if we see that, let's say if any event happened last year and in spite of that kind of event, the sales have been pretty competitive and on the mark as compared to their competition. So that's why you need to see the total revenue of the company. It's not the best indicator, but then when you will see cost of sales, you will see operating expenses. You will see that if this was early pandemic 2020, it has not changed. Like, just look at here. We're talking about March 2020, right? And then we are talking about March 2019. Now, if you see operating expenses, not much changed. If you see total operating expenses, not much changed. So during these times, and now there has, after March, there was a pandemic again, right? So when we are looking at the results, we have to understand that there are different ways to see these results, and all the factors should be covered. How much is the sales? How much is the cost of making sales? And has there been any unforeseen market event which has caused these sales to go up or down? So Apple, if you see this report right now, you can say that they have slightly increased its sales compared to both the quarters. But then they did all this while dealing with the pandemic. So for Apple specifically, they had went through closing of stores. A lot of Apple stores were closed, so they had to make a lot of adjustments. So all these kind of things actually go in favor of Apple. Now, there are ways that you can interpret these earnings in a lot of ways. And that's how we try to even find out whether the company is actually worth to do more research on or not. Currently, I'm looking at this report and I see, their sales have changed a little. But then Apple has to deal with the pandemic in last few months. And then also they had to close down their stores. As per that, it's pretty good. So this is a company which is much more stronger than I thought. And I'll go ahead with it, right? So this is something which you can see by looking at the total revenue. So again, guys, different ways to interpret it. Also, it's very easy to calculate the total revenue, as we were about to discuss about this here. So how you calculate it, whatever the total number of quantities were sold, you can multiply by the price and that's your total revenue. But also, since we are analyzing more and more Apple right now, if you see the segmented revenue, why segment revenue is important? Now, segment revenue is what? If you can see in this slide, segment revenue simply means that the revenue from different segments, from iPhone, from iPad, from Mac, from services. Services stands for App Store. And then there are other products like iWatch, AirPods, right? So what was the highest performing segment? What was the lowest performing segment? How this segment performed now as compared to a year ago and as compared to a quarter ago, right? So this way you can also, and this information is very easily available, and you can always see this kind of information, that how the segmented revenue, like for example, Amazon has a different, Amazon has a good amount of revenue coming from the cloud services, right? We all know Amazon is an e-commerce company, but then they're also into cloud. Amazon Web Services, they deal with cloud. So their revenue from cloud is also increasing, and cloud is something which is the next thing. So this can be a good idea for us to be more invested into Amazon, right? So this way, and again, guys, before we move to the other segment, why total revenue is important to the business owners? So let's talk about, let's say, if anybody, for example, has produced something, right? And they know that this is my particular product and this much is the cost which has been incurred. Now, total revenue is quantity sold into the price, right? But the price has to be decided, that at what price we are going to put this to generate a specific amount of profit. So there are a lot of factors which comes, like if, for example, if total revenue, let's say, appears acceptable, then for example, what are the tax obligations? If my revenue is this much, then I can take away some taxes, or let's say I can modify my pricing accordingly. If the revenue is too low, then example, for if any other expenses are to be done, it will not be able to be taken care of. So any additional revenue streams we need, and we get, so why we know and why we want the segmented revenue and why we want to understand about the segmented revenue is for the reason that if there is one particular sector which is growing really well, so for Apple, and it's a live example, in last few weeks, in last few months actually, we have seen Apple prices, Apple stock prices going higher. And one of the major reason is that their revenue from the services sector, which is App Store, it has been increasing. So iPhone sales is iPhone sales, but if they start giving revenue from App Store also, that's a plus point, that's an additional revenue stream. So that is one of the most important part you need to see in the segmented revenue. So every company has different segments. GE will have aviation, transportation, light, electric, etc. Apple has services, they have other products like AirPods, they have other products like Mac, iPad, etc. Similarly, Amazon has Amazon Web Services and e-commerce. So this way, when you analyze each segment separately, you will get to know, if Amazon's revenue is mostly coming from the cloud services, so cloud is the next thing. So this is something which is really good, right? So this is the importance of the total revenue, and more especially segmented revenue, right? And then comes cost of sales. Now, you cannot do anything until you know the cost. Cost is everything when it comes to... So if you see the whole Apple example, if to neatly put it into words, if Apple only sold computers, then the cost of manufacturing the computer and packaging it and selling it, that is your cost, right? So the cost of goods sold, so COGS, what you see here, it is also called cost of goods sold. It is also called cost of sales, cost of services. Basically, how much it costed to produce the product or a service. So it includes direct expenses. It does not include indirect expenses. We'll further understand what are direct, what are indirect. So basically, the raw material and manufacturing expenses which are needed, without which the product cannot be manufactured or created. Product can be created without advertising, without distribution expenses, without promotional expenses, but it cannot be created without purchasing the raw material. So those are called direct expenses. If there is no machinery, then they cannot be produced. So expenses done on that is called direct expenses. So when you're looking at the cost of sales, you really have to understand cost of sales will outline how much cost has been incurred to produce the goods. And again, it's like a one-stop shop for analyzing company's performance. It will tell you raw materials used to produce the goods are getting more expensive or not, right? Because if raw materials are, for example, getting more expensive, then the cost is also increasing. So for you, it's an eye-opener that, okay, this is the instrument which is getting more and more expensive. So cost of sales is also something which you look into a earnings report as well. So all, again, guys, as I said, all these informations are very easily available. And as an investor, if you are getting much more into detailed analysis, this is something which can really make you understand whether to invest or not. Then comes your gross margin. Now, gross margin is a little different from the gross profit. Because when I say the word gross, everybody would understand that, okay, gross profit. But that's not what we are talking about. Now, and I will even show you on the sheet that how the gross margin looks like. Now, when we talk about, guys, gross margin is mostly, just to understand, again, cost is the most important thing. But at the end of the day, we have to understand what is from the cost to my selling price. So what is the formula for calculating a gross margin? If you see it here, net sales minus cost of goods sold. Now, when you look at gross margin, it will not include all the expenses. It will obviously not give you a complete picture of the company, whether it is doing good or bad, but a higher level data point to understand how wider the margins are. So just to sum up, if the higher the gross margin, more capital a company retains on each dollar of sales, which it can then use to pay other cost or satisfy debt obligation, which means whatever the total sales, net sales, you deduct the cost of goods sold and then you divide it by the total sales multiplied by 100. So you get gross margin ratio. So from your total cost till the selling price, how much difference you keep. From the difference between the selling price and the cost is your gross profit. The difference between the cost and the total selling price which you have kept. So we are talking about the direct cost, the manufacturing cost also. As I said, the gross margin is not including all other expenses, right? So the total direct expenses which you see from there till the selling price, how much is the gross margin? Okay. When you see gross profit, that is basically the entire cost and difference between the entire cost and the price at which you have sold it. So that's your gross profit. Gross margin, the direct cost, and difference between the direct cost and the selling price. So gross margin is more like how much wider and how much space a company has. Because if gross margin starts shrinking, that is the very first sign and it's a cause for concern. So whenever you are looking at any statement, income statement or balance sheet or cash flow statement, wherever the gross margin is mentioned, if the gross margins, they start shrinking, that will not help the company to pay any other cost, or if they have to satisfy any other obligations related to debts, that could be a big problem. So we always look at the gross margins also, right? So guys, again, as I'm saying, these are something which you can always look into these areas. There will be experts who can help you out in understanding how these things work, because at the end of the day, this is not, you are not an accountant, you are not going to sit and analyze all these reports, but then you can always look into these things. This is something which is going to give you a very good experience of how, what are the areas which I should definitely look into, right? So far, guys, if you have any other questions, please ask. I'm sure not at the very first instance, all these things will be clear. So if you have anything which is going on in your mind, you can always write it over the chat option and I'll be able to answer your question. So what we have done so far, we have talked about gross margin, we have talked about cost of sales, we have talked about total revenue, and then we have also talked about the income statement. So income statement is giving us the revenue, expenses, profits, then followed by total revenue. We understood what is the importance of the segments, different segments of the revenue by taking examples from Amazon and Apple. We also understood that what is the cost of sales. So cost of sales is basically how much cost is there to manufacture, to create the product. And then we are talking about gross margin, which we understood net sales minus the cost divided by net sales, and you will get your gross margin. Now, next is your operating expenses. So if you see, if you go back in the previous statement, which I was showing it to you, at the very bottom, you see there are operating expenses, right? So we'll zoom this in the slide and we'll see. Now, operating expenses, as the name suggests, these are the cost which comes while you're operating your business. Now, operating expenses is also very important because, as I say, many people would not give it much importance. I will always definitely look at it just for some data, because this includes cost of research and development, marketing, and that's important from my point of view. But if you just have a look, because this cost is going to add to the overall cost of the running the business, and it does reduce its margin. If the cost is too high, it will reduce the profit margin also. It is extremely difficult to determine the story behind these numbers just by looking at it. Because if you see, so we are looking at Apple's operating expenses right now. And if you see, as compared to previous quarter on the right side to the current quarter, Apple's operating expenses have gone up a bit, right? Now, am I concerned about this? Not really, because more money spent on research and development, it is actually a good thing. And if you see, for Apple, more research and development they do, more updated technology they come up with. Now, I'm sure not everybody's excited about iPhone 12. It just looks a bit more like iPhone 5. But for a tech company, especially, research and development expenditure is good, because more they do research and development, more upgraded technology they are into, which again opens additional revenue streams. So operating expenses are also something which you can have a look and see whether it has gone up by too much or what is the difference as compared to the previous quarter, right? Because if they're testing new technology, and again, guys, this information will be readily available. So the point of the matter is, why you look at operating expenses? Because if they are really doing more and more research and the cost is going higher, then the new technology, they might be working on a new technology which could be a separate income stream in the future. iPhone was never this slim, or Samsung was never foldable, right? But they have spent money on the research and development. They come up with a new technology. And like this, there are a lot of stocks which are working on new technology. More companies are working on new technology. So this could open, give them that niche which every company wants in the market. So operating expenses can also be something which you should look at. So this is just a snapshot of how the operating expenses of Apple looks like. Now, this is for every company. Again, guys, I'm just giving you very selected snapshots of few things. There is a lot of things in financial statement, and that's why there are experts who study them. But then this is not something which you cannot do. Please do not think that this is some kind of rocket science which only expert can do. If you spend some time and try to understand it, this is something which is really easy. It's a piece of cake. These are just numbers. Then, as I said, we'll discuss about net income. So net income, total profits, deducting all business expenses. To put it in a very easy manner without confusing this, when we talk about net income, what is your net income, for example? Your net income is the total money you receive, out of which your total expenditure, so the remaining saving line is your net income. And this is the bottom line, because this is literally at the bottom line. If you look at the statement, this is exactly at the bottom line of the company. This is your net income. Now, when you look at the cash flow statement, look at the last line of it, net income appears over there. It is an excellent, excellent metric if you want to assess the company. Like, it will quickly tell you that how much the company made after all the cost of the running business have been taken out. And please, it's really important to know that company whose net income is negative, it is not always a bad thing, because some businesses might take some years to turn a profit, and that is okay because they're building a base for a stronger future. So if, like, for example, if you go back and you know, this could be your assignment, just go back and you would see Uber's very first quarter, when they came up with their earnings, their total operating expenses and the total loss which they had in the minus all the operating expenses, it was actually a net loss. And there was a lot of deficit, which increased quarter on quarter over a period of time. But the point is, this in itself does not make Uber a very bad investment, because there are a lot of factors to consider. You consider their earning per shares, you consider their stock price as compared to their competitors like Lyft and others. So you always have to see net income. It will give you a quick snapshot of how much money the company is making. But then if you go and do further analysis, you have to see why the net income is negative. Is that because of higher operating expenses? Operating expenses might include R&D expenses, research and development, which might be used for building a better technology. So this is, again, something if you do a deeper analysis and look into it, you can easily find out, right? I hope so far, at least whatever I have said, 50% is understandable to you. For the rest of the 50%, if you're not able to understand, we can always have a one-on-one conversation over Zoom or in the office, and we can always look much more into details. What I have done is I have tried to reduce this whole plethora of content into a one-hour session so that it is much more easier for you to understand as well. So just to make sure that most of you stay and don't run away, tell me the answer to this question. I have put a poll here. Please feel free to Google, search around. What was the opening gap in Facebook stock today? Was it up by 4 to 5% or was it down by 4 to 5%? Feel free, guys. Feel free to vote for this. What was the opening gap in Facebook? Was it up by 4 to 5% or was it down by 4 to 5%? That means if Facebook closed yesterday at $265, so today did it open up by $10, $11 or it opened down by $10, $11? Please feel free to search on Google. This is a very important news today. One of the important news today, actually, a lot of clients had invested in Facebook and have been investing in Facebook for last few months. Okay. I'm going to give 5 more seconds. Sorry. 5 more seconds before the poll ends. Okay. So I'm going to end this poll now. I hope everybody can see the results. 66% of them said yes, Facebook has opened up by 4 to 5%. 33% said no. Obviously, you did not go and search. You could have searched, would have got the answer. So Facebook actually opened $12 higher, $11 higher than the stock price, which means if you bought Facebook yesterday 100 shares, today you are making $12 profit per share. So this is a gap up opening, which means it opened at a gap. It did not open at 265 and then went to 280. It opened at 279 and 280, which means a gap up opening. We'll look into this chart and we'll see what also happens, right? So we discussed about net income, guys. Now, next thing, earning per share. Because earning per share is one of the important areas which you should see. And earning per share doesn't mean that if a company has made a dollar in earning per share, that means if you have 1,000 shares, you get $1,000. Because this is a very common question which is asked. So this is one of the most important measures that can actually tell about the company's financial health. Because when you see earning per share, whatever is the total, the net income, and when you reduce down the dividend from those income, because there's a dividend which is preferred dividend, which has been, which is supposed to be given for sure, because it's a, it is for the preference shareholders, the shareholders which have a preference to get this dividend. So out of the net income, the compulsory dividend once is paid, whatever is the remaining income, divide by the total number of outstanding shares. So if Apple has 1 billion shareholders and the net income is, say, 2 billion, then 2 billion divided by 1 billion, they made $2 per share. So how productive the capital has been used. Higher the company's earning per share, more profitable it is considered. So again, as you can see, if all companies' profits are paid out to the shareholders, EPS is the portion of a company's net income that would be allocated to each outstanding share, right? So whatever is the net income, the remaining income per share is what earning per share is. Now, what happens during the earnings? So going next, okay, before we discuss the PE ratio, let's understand that how to interpret the earnings season, because now we have taken out major factors. The few other factors, guys, which you can always look at, because we'll discuss earning per share also. Earning per share and both PE ratio also, and then we'll talk about how it impacts the market. But more than that, you can also look at the free cash flow. Free cash flow, it's more like how much free cash company has generated in a quarter. And this is not something which you have to calculate manually. They calculate, all the firms, they calculate it and they subtract all the expenditures and show you the operating cash flow. So this is something which you can look for. You can also look for any legal proceedings or scandals which are going on, any risk factors. So in Apple, we talked about the pandemic because they had to close down the stores. So you should always look for the risk factors. You should for the legal proceedings, if there is any, like if you have heard of lately, Google has been sued by antitrust authorities. So this is also which can be really important before you invest into the stock. There will be a lot of news around it, but then their own report, I think, is something which can be easily interpreted. And it should give you a good starting point, you know, where to actually start from, right? Now, coming back to the earning per share, we understood that you can also look at the cash flow, the free cash flow of the company. When we talk about the earning per share, three things. And I'm going to write it down. So please write it down in your notebook. Earning per share, which is also called EPS. Then there is revenue, and then there is forward outlook. So we are looking at three factors right now. Whenever the earnings comes out, okay, earning of any particular company comes out, you have to see these three factors most importantly, apart from what we discussed. So one of them is earning per share. Other is the total revenue, which has come. And then last but not the least, the forward outlook. Why or what is the next quarter outlook? So when you discuss about these results, you always think about, okay, what it is going to be like in the next few quarters, right? Or in the next one quarter, what it is going to be like. So that is something which you have to really understand. And you have to see all these three things. And every earnings news has this thing which is always going on. So you can always look into the earnings report and earning per share, total revenue, quarter on quarter, year on year, earning per share, quarter on quarter, same quarter last year. You should be able to check. There was one question which I just saw. Sorry, let me just answer the question as well, since a lot of you have been asking it here. Google is going higher after the case filed. Please comment. So just to reiterate, what has happened is Google was sued. It was hit by one of the biggest US antitrust case in this generation. So Department of Justice have actually alleged that the company is using monopoly power in the web search market to freeze out competition. So this is something which, so antitrust is this authority which always keep wants to regulate the tech stocks. So they always keep a check that tech stocks should not create a monopoly. So what Google is basically being sued for, right? Normally, this kind of news will pull the stocks down. And this, even this particular news, it could turn into a management headache because there are lawyers, lawyers comes in and then they go to court. And for years, there are a lot of things company might have to pay fines. How they their entire model of business can be changed, how they conduct the business. Because the way Google conducts a business, that could be around 60% of their sales and even more of the profit, right? And other sorts of cases can also be filed. But even if you see after all this news, Google shares went up. It has been going higher since yesterday after the news came. So let's understand that why the stock did not take a hit. And it's a very good question, so I would answer it right away. See, the lawsuit had very few major surprises and many elements that investors actually expected. So it's not for today that Google has been sued and they have found out today that they have been doing this monopoly. Google has been in the news for a very long time. Like Google search default deals have always been in focus. Some Wall Street analysts also have done a lot of research about this. And there is a lot of speculation that any eventual remedies will not have a very deep impact on Google's ability to make money. They are leaders in the search advertising. That is one thing, right? So there is a very limited risk to Google from this particular suit. And in the end, if you see, the US government could force Google to stop paying partners like Apple, for example, billions of dollars to make it search engine the default on their device and browsers. So what Google can do, if Google is paying billions of dollars to Apple, that, you know, you make this, make our search engine as a default on your device or on your browser, they might, US government might tell Google to stop paying them. But even then, users have more choices. They might end up even gravitating towards Google anyway. Today, if you want to search, I'm telling you right now, search about Facebook stock. So I did not say search, I said Google about Facebook stock. So that thing has been established. It could have been very worse for the company. I mean, a lot of people have started telling Google to be broken up, that the search engine should be separated from other services that are, you know, that are intertwined. Basically, YouTube is also Google. Google Map is also Google. Advertising technology is Google. Chrome is Google. Android is. So there have been a lot of talks about breaking Google up, but then there is no guarantee. I mean, Google can come through the antitrust order, of course. Lot of attorney, the generals are planning the other action. There's a lot of complaints also over Google's conduct in the digital advertising market, because it is said that they control much of the technology used by the advertisers and publishers to buy and sell display ads across the web. So there are a lot of things, but the reason why it did not fall, because this is not something which is new. So a news which could affect the stock adversely is not affecting because it's not really new and it is not going to impact Google or stop them from making that kind of money. So that was the reason. Now, second thing, when I was talking about how you interpret the Google, how you interpret the earnings report is look at three factors: EPS, revenue, and forward outlook. All these report, they come directly, even on your messages, if you are there and signed up for Century Messages, you get earnings on your text that what was the expected. So there is a panel of Wall Street analysts who are studying the reports, studying the numbers of a company. And on those basis, they come up with a consensus, the expectation of how much a earning per share should be. And if the company comes up with the expected number or outperforms the expectation of the Wall Street analyst, the stock mostly goes up, given that the revenue is also in line with the expectation and the forward outlook, the outlook for the next quarter is also expected to be better. And I'll give you a live example of this, what happened yesterday with Netflix, because impact of earnings, guys, is really important. So let me take you to the live platform and show you here. I will take a pause on this presentation and take you to the live platform where we will look today the Netflix stock. So the Netflix stock came out with the earnings yesterday night and they missed on their earnings expectations. The analyst expected somewhere around $2 per share, but it was less than that. Their total users also declined. Revenue also did not meet in line with the expectations. So if you see today, so this chart, what you see here, let me show you and highlight this. This was the closing on 20th October. Let me increase the size of the text. If you see, I click here, it says 20th October. 20th October, it closed at 527. And 21st October, it opened, if you see, opened 501, $27 down. And currently, it is trading at 490. If you see here on the right corner, red, it is down by 6.5%. It is down by $27, $28. Why? Only because their earnings did not reach to the expectations. Right, guys? So this is something which you have to understand, that why it is really important for the stocks to come up with the positive earnings. And if they don't come up with the positive earnings, there's a possibility that again, they might not perform well, right? So this is one thing. Revenue and forward outlook. Revenue, as I said, the revenue from the previous quarter and the previous year, same quarter is compared. And if it is higher than the previous, it's good, but it should also beat the expectations. And this is the time when earnings are going on. So guys, lot of volatility is expected. Something what we are doing these days is the impact of earnings season. If you see just a small example, I'll show you. Ad agency MNC Saatchi saw its share price tank last year after it revealed past accounting errors, which meant it had to book a charge of £6.4 million. Now, this was something which affected the stock so much that you see this in the chart, that the stock started falling and then it went down almost by 50% over the extended period of time. Just because during the earnings, they came up with this particular issue. So this is something which can really impact the stock price. This is not something which is not important, because earnings are report card. Report card means results, how much money a company is making. It comes every quarter and you will see great volatility, so much of movement in the stock prices. So that is something which is really important. Now, something what we are doing these days, the price action analysis, how you try to trade the earnings, because this is really important. Before I discuss about the PE ratio, I think that is the only topic remaining. I would just jump on to the strategy, what we have been using, and most of our consultants, they have been trying to work on this. Price action analysis is when we study the previous movement of the companies after their earnings came. So what was the movement on the stock price after the earnings came out? I'll give you a few examples. So we have created these flyers. Again, guys, these are for illustration purposes. Please look at this. I'm not suggesting any trade or anything. Just look at these flyers and see how it works out. So today, for example, here. I hope everybody can see this. I will still zoom it further. Now, guys, price action analysis of Lam Research and Tesla on earnings. Historical analysis of past 10 years for the first quarter. Here, if you see, now look at Tesla, for example. Guys, how price action analysis strategy is done? The earnings date of Tesla is 22nd October. This is tomorrow. So tomorrow, for sure, you will experience a lot of movement in Tesla stock. So be ready. Anybody who has open position in Tesla, please be ready. Now, earnings date for Tesla is tomorrow. Now, historically, what we have seen, if you enter a day before earnings, which is today, 21st October, and exit on the day of earnings, which means closing of October 22nd, one day, we did analysis for last 10 years. So this is Q3, third quarter 2020 result. So we checked 2019 third quarter result, 2018 third quarter, 2017 third quarter, 2016, 2015, 2014, all the way to 2010. And what we've understood that every time if you enter a day before the earning of Tesla and exit on the day of earning of the Tesla by the closing of the day, the stock has moved up by 18% last year, 9% before that, negative 7% in 2017, 1% positive in 2016, 11% high upside movement in 2015, 4% upside movement in 2014, 15% negative. All in all, if you see the Q3 average price movement in Tesla, if you enter one day before the earning and exit on the day of earning, the average movement is 5.3% upside. The probability of gain in price out of these 10 years, 3 times it was negative. So the probability of gain is 70%. Maximum gain, which you can see, is 19%. If you can see in this particular column, highest it has gone is 19%. Maximum loss you can see, maximum drop in price you can see, is 14.5%. Another thing, if you enter into the stock day before earning, right, but you keep it, say, for the 10 days, which is November 4. If you keep it for 10 days, the probability, again, 70% of gain in price, highest you can see is 8.8%. Lowest you can see Q3 average return is 8.8%. Maximum gain 40% if you hold the stock for 10 days. Drop 28% maximum if you hold for 10 days. But most interestingly, if you see, if you enter a week after the earnings, okay, and hold it for the next 20 days, and this analysis which we did in last 10 years, that had people did this, the average gain in those 20 days after the earning is declared is 4.9%. But the probability of gain in price is actually 90% as compared to last 10-year performance. Highest gain 14% and maximum drop we have seen is 7.9%. Now, like this, we are doing, guys, for all the stocks. We are trying to study all these stocks and how they have reacted after the earnings came out. So this is something which is not everybody is doing. Price action analysis is a very important strategy. It's a very good strategy which you can try. So that is, again, so somebody asked me, what is the expectation? Who decides the expectation? Expectation of the earnings, it is decided by the estimates, the analyst on the Wall Street. And there's a whole consensus form of the panel of the analyst. So if the stock performs to the expectations, outperforms the expectations, have a positive impact. If the underperforms the expectation, most of the time it will have negative impact, as you saw in the price of Netflix. So like this price action analysis, what you saw here, I'll just show you one more. So something which you can probably relate to here. Okay, so this is AT&T and Southwest Airlines. This is, again, guys, this is today. As you can see, there's a date, 21st October. You can always see it for tomorrow. You can see tomorrow for yourself. In fact, I would heavily request, please take demo accounts right now from your RMs and take these stocks, AT&T, Southwest, for the day and see how it works out. Just follow the price action analysis. Could be a loss, could be a profit. This is the best way to know, right? That how backtested data can help you to form a strategy. Again, 10 years of data for Southwest. So as we can see, 50% probability of gain in price if you buy the stock before, one day before the earning, and sell it after the day of earning. Keep it for 2 days, only 0.3% return, 50% probability. The 80% probability of gain in price is if you buy the stock 1 week after the earning and keep it for the next 20 days before you exit. So higher probability, 80% times it has given positive returns. Average return in Southwest is 3.5% if we go with this kind of strategy, right? While you see on the other side, AT&T has a history of giving most of the time negative movement after the stock has declared earnings. So gain in price probability, 30%, 30%, barely 10%, but losing is more, right? So you can short sell a stock if that is what the expectation is. So this is also something which you can try, right? So guys, again, if you have any questions, please write about price action analysis is something what we exclusively do. So if you have any kind of doubts or questions, you can ask and we'll be able to answer. Do not take the trade just by looking at here. First, understand what is the risk, what is the expectation, how it is done, how much leverage you are taking, where to put the stop loss, everything, right? Before I end this, let me go back to one thing which we left and which was the PE ratio. Because PE ratio is also, so after you have seen what are the important factors in earning, you need to see what is a PE ratio and how price earning ratio is important. So PE ratio does not come up with the earning result, but PE ratio is something after you have seen the earnings and everything, you can always compare the PE ratio of the different stocks, but within the same industry. So if Apple, Microsoft, these are tech stocks within the tech industry, Apple and Samsung, for example. So you can compare their PE ratio to understand that which stock is overvalued or expensive and which stock is undervalued, right? So just to give a little more information to you about how important the PE ratio is called the price earning ratio. And whatever is the current stock price of, for example, if Netflix is $525 or $490, you divide it by the earning per share of Netflix and you will get the PE ratio. And this is a relationship between a company's stock price and its earning per share. It will definitely give you a better sense of value of the company because it kind of shows the expectation of the market and the price which you must pay per unit of their current earnings or the future earnings. So as compared to their current earnings, the price which you should ideally pay for this stock, this is the relationship which price to earning ratio shows. Because earnings are really important. So when you're valuing a company's stock, investors want to know how profitable a company is. So they need to know the earnings. Even in the future, how profitable a company will be, you can easily determine by looking at the earnings. But if the company doesn't grow and the current level of earnings, they are constant, then the PE can be interpreted and you can see that how much number of years it will take for the company to pay back the amount which is which they have taken for each share. So PE ratio definitely tells you the current price and then you divide it by the earning per share and you get your PE ratio. Now, an important part which everybody keeps asking, that why you're using the price earning ratio. Now, investors, they always want to buy financially sound companies, right? Which offer a very good ROI. This is a very basic understanding. Any person who wants to buy any stock, he wants a better ROI. Among all the ratios, PE is something which is a part of a research process for selecting that stock. Because we as an analyst, we can figure out whether we are paying a fair price or not. The companies within the same industry, they're grouped together and we do a comparison regardless of different stock prices. So if Tesla stock price is say $500 per share and Microsoft is $200 per share. So not Tesla, let's say Apple stock price is $115 per share and Microsoft is $200. So we don't have to understand the stock price. We will group all these tech stocks together. Okay. And then we will compare their PE ratio, which will be much more easier. So if PE ratio of Apple is 15 and Microsoft is 12, so Microsoft PE ratio is less and Apple's PE ratio is higher. You cannot compare Microsoft and Coca-Cola. You cannot compare Apple and ExxonMobil because those are different sectors. You have to compare the PE ratios of companies which are into the similar industry, and every industry has an average PE ratio to which the company can be higher or lower, right? So this is something which can be. Now, what means a higher PE ratio? A higher PE ratio is considered to be a sign of that you are looking at a growth stock, which means that in a future, there is a positive performance coming and investors have a higher expectation for the future earnings. And that's why they are willing to pay more for these companies. Now, what is the downside to this? That the volatility in these kind of companies is very high. So there is a lot of pressure on these companies to do more than what is expected. So if you see the tech stocks are always volatile because there is always more, their PEs are always high. So investing in growth stocks can always be seen, most of the time can be a risky investment. So stock with higher PE ratios can also be considered overvalued. That's a separate tangent, but this is how normally you interpret a higher PE ratio. Lower PE on the other side, these are more like value stocks because their stock price right now is trading lower relative to its fundamentals. And it can be a good bargain for the investors to buy the stock before the market goes down. So the idea is a value stock, which has a lower PE, most of the times it is found in mature industries which are giving you good dividends. So the industries, for example, companies like ExxonMobil or Coca-Cola, these kind of companies were giving higher dividends. They will have lower PEs. They would have lower PE ratios. So you can easily find out a good PE ratio, compare it with the industry standards. So between Apple and Microsoft, which one to pick? Higher PE means could be overvalued, but then investors are willing to pay more money for this particular company, right? Which means they have more confidence over this company. It could lead to overvaluation, but then that's where you have to find a balance, right? I hope this is, the PE ratio is clear. That's why I waited till the last that I should be able to explain you the PE ratio. One question, Southwest is not at all flying or few flights. It will be different, right? So Southwest Airlines is one of the most, so we have been suggesting, putting this Southwest Airlines a lot of times in our portfolios because among all the airlines, Southwest has a much more stronger balance sheet in terms of fundamentals. And Southwest Airlines is a domestic airline. If you see the world travel, the international travel was banned for a long period of time, but domestic travel started first. So that was also one of the reasons that why even Southwest, among their entire area of domestic airlines, Southwest has much more stronger balance sheet. So that's why it has been preferred a lot of times. So domestic airlines, they're still flying. So, and plus, off lately, there has been increase in the footfall in the airports also. So if you see yesterday or day before, the airline industry, most of the airline industry stocks were higher due to this news, right? We understood how to interpret the earnings season. We understood the forward outlook, impact of earnings season. Definitely, we understood the impact and the price action analysis. Next thing, big thing, which is coming, guys, before I leave you with this. US election is coming. Those who are already clients, who have leveraged positions, please keep your account well funded. Margins during such events can be increased by the broker. So you have to make sure that your account is well funded. Please do not take higher leverage, manage your risk properly. US election is going to be one of the most volatile trading sessions in the history of the financial market. It has happened in 2016. It can happen in 2020 again. Be awake, be alert. If you have positions open, there will be a lot of trading and investment opportunities, but please be safe and put all the risk management. Talk to your experts, talk to your consultants, and try to make the best use of this. So I'm going to do one more session on 28th of October. This will be on the impact of US elections on your investment, which sectors you can look into before the elections, post elections, what are the sectors you can look at, what is the expectation from the market, who is expected to be the president. However, we can always take assumptions. It's going to be one of the most interacting event. I will bring Vivian also to just understand the technical perspective. So that is something which we are looking forward next on 28th of October. So guys, once again, thank you so much for your time. I could not thank you enough for taking out time and be a part of this session. I hope this was worth your time. please review us on Google, review Century Financial Google. If you like the session, you didn't like the session, something you want us to improve on, this is really important for us. These are awareness sessions, which we always do every week. And we're trying to spread more and more awareness about how to manage your risk, how to look at balance sheets, how to look at earnings data, how to decipher the market information, which can be useful for you, right? So once again, thank you so much. On behalf of Century Financial, my team, myself, a big vote of thanks to everyone who is connected to healthcare sector or medical area, doctors, midwives, first responders. Please, thank you so much for doing what you're doing. These are tough times for all of us. And I hope that we get over with it. And again, walk freely without a mask, although we need to carry this for some time. We have to be safe, avoid gatherings, keep yourself safe, use sanitizers, and most importantly, look forward to US elections. Keep yourself invested. Do not get scared of the market, but please manage your risk properly. Our experts and consultants will be available for your assistance. Do talk to your RMs and take some demo accounts and try to use the price action analysis today so you can see the immediate results tomorrow. My name is Yogesh. You have a good night ahead. We'll meet soon next week with a different topic, with a lot of different content and a lot of more information.